deep in the bowels of a hidden bunker, somewhere under the brick and steel of a nondescript building, we've once again made contact with our leader, Mark Levin.
Mr. Producer, would you open your mic, please? Barack Obama defends Black Lives Matter. Barack Obama tomorrow is supposed to give a speech on policing and the black community. Barack Obama has helped to create the environment we live in today, the anxiety, the instability, the heightened racial tensions that are in this country today, which can, in fact, lead to violence because it's difficult to control once it's unleashed. Here he is in Madrid, Spain yesterday, in part. Cut 10, go.
As you prepare yourself to travel to Dallas, how would you advise the Black Lives Matter activists to approach this very sensitive issue?
One of the great things about America is that individual citizens and groups of citizens can petition their government, can protest, can speak truth to power. And that is sometimes messy and controversial. But because of that ability to protest and engage in free speech, America over time has gotten better.
So stop right there. Two points I wish to raise. He never spoke so glowingly of the Tea Party movement, did he? So he really doesn't believe that conservatives, constitutionalists, whatever, should be treated with such courtesy and respect, does he? He mocked them. The Wall Street Journal page mocked them, us. Others mocked us. The Republican leadership mocked us. Some on Fox mocked us. The liberal media mocked us. We're not even violent. And we're not trying to overthrow anything. We're trying to enforce our Constitution on people who appear to reject it, either passively or aggressively. But furthermore, notice how he glamorizes the Black Lives Matter movement, their hateful signs, their disruption, their violence. Notice how he glamorizes that movement. Continue, please.
We've all benefited from that. The abolition movement was contentious.
Now stop. So the abolition movement actually was more than contentious, genius. It resulted in a civil war. But that said, now he's comparing. He starts the process of comparing what is a violent movement or a movement that has the potential of being incredibly violent, filled with malcontents who attack liberty and security and stability, who are racists, compares it with the abolition movement. Now, as much as you and I think this is an absurdity, this is a big window into this guy's mind. In other words, what I said is he's a Marxist who embraces Alinskyite tactics, and he's explaining that to you now without saying that he's explaining it to you now. You see my point? You with me, Mr. Producer? You with me, my blessed audience? This is crucially important. Go ahead.
The effort for women to get the right to vote was contentious and messy. There were times when activists might have engaged in rhetoric that was overheated.
This is his indoctrination. This was his original career as a community disorganizer. And he sees this as the natural flow, even though it's utterly perverse to those of us who are clear thinking. Go ahead.
Occasionally counterproductive, but the point was to raise issues so that we as a society could grapple with them. The same was true with the civil rights movement and the union movement and the environmental movement and the anti-war movement during Vietnam.
Now stop. Now get ready for this last sentence. Go ahead.
And I think what you're seeing now is part of that long-standing tradition.
So Black Lives Matter is part of that long-standing tradition. What Obama is saying, now listen to me, this is an ongoing revolution against the American heritage, which at its very core needs to be destroyed. He embraces movements. Movements, in many cases, that were seeking to perfect what the founders had done and perfect what the framers could not accomplish in Philadelphia. And then he projects the radicalism and even, and I'll have to say it, even the violent attitude and the hateful attitude of groups like Black Lives Matter onto it. It's just part of a progression for him. And you people out there, whatever your color, by the way, and whatever your background, you people out there who work for a living, pay your taxes, follow the law, mind your own business, take care of your kids, you don't get to just do those things. Remember what I said about Marx? The hell with the family. The hell with your private property. Society must be destroyed from within. And this new utopian statism needs to take its place. Marx would call it communism. I call this all utopian statism, which, of course, is anything but. But that's how they sell it. What you're seeing now is part of that long-standing tradition. And so rather than learn from what I called, what I said Friday, is his political, I called him a political arsonist Friday. I said he lights matches and he throws them all over the place and he pours fuel in the fire. That's what he does. So rather than learn from that, rather than back off, rather than seeing the violence that's going on out there, and he'll say, look, that's wrong. The language is wrong. You're not supposed to do that. But in the end, he sees it all as a natural progression. That's how he sees it. That's how he sees it. And so he has unleashed his administration, both in terms of action and rhetoric. You remember Eric Holder in Ferguson, Missouri, and Obama and Holder when they talked about Baltimore, and Obama now. And you see their actions nationalizing the suburbs, nationalizing local police departments. They have to be trained better, don't you know, meaning indoctrinated. Well, you know what? Let's play this cut 10 again. Let's play it without interruption, as difficult as it is. It's a minute and a half, and then I want to juxtapose it to something else, okay? He's asked about the Black Lives Matter activists. Cut 10, go.
As you prepare yourself to travel to Dallas, how would you advise the Black Lives Matter activists to approach this very sensitive issue?
One of the great things about America is that individual citizens and groups of citizens can petition their government, can protest, can speak truth to power. And that is sometimes messy and controversial, but because of that ability to protest and engage in free speech, America over time has gotten better. We've all benefited from that. You know, the abolition movement was contentious.
All right, that's enough. It wasn't that long ago, ladies and gentlemen, about a year and a half ago, December 2014, when Black Lives Matter was marching through the streets of New York City, chanting the following, go.
Sit up, down.
What do we want? Dead cops. When do we want it? Now. Remember that? Louder. Oh, I keep hearing what a peaceful group this is. Oh, they were so peaceful in Dallas. They were taunting cops after the shooting. They're carrying these vile signs that the media have done a great job to sort of block out. Oh, yes. Tea Party movement. One rally. One LaRouche's carrying some Nazi sign or a picture of Hitler, and then they taint the entire Tea Party movement, everybody in it, every single rally. Yes, there's a double standard in this country. If you're a hardworking, patriotic American who loves his country, who provides for his family, pays taxes, who asks nothing of anybody, you're a sucker. If you're an illegal alien, you're noble. If you're a part of some radical left-wing kook group, whether it's CARE or Black Lives Matter or whatever the hell it is, you're carrying the traditions of America, don't you know? According to the Marxist Alinskyite, Barack, Milhouse, Benito, Obama. What do we want? They said, dead cops. When do we want it? Now. Now, isn't it interesting? All the media have that video. All of them. They can play it. They could remind us what Black Lives Matter is. But they don't. Why? Barack Obama speaks of this group as if it's some kind of a wonderful movement, like the abolitionist movement or the suffrage movement, because he is a radical ideologue. That's why.